Welcome to Customer Tech Talks. Thanks for joining us. Today, I'm joined by Walter from OBB, an Austrian railway operator. But before we kick off the interview, let's learn a little more.
ÖBB Personenverkehr AG provides public transportation in Austria and is Austria's largest mobility service provider. With over 4,000 trains and 30,000 bus routes available, every day more than 1 million passengers travel on our rail and road transport services. ÖBB Ticketshop is the ticket selling platform for ÖBB Personenverkehr. Our goal is to make it as easy as possible for customers to buy tickets, whether they would like to buy a ticket via website, app, vending machine, ticket counter, or train attendant. We are currently moving to the Azure platform to be able to give our customers a safe and reliable service and to get innovations to them as fast as possible.
I'm joined today by Walter Pongratz, Technical Architect for OBB Ticket Shop. Walter, thanks for joining us.
Hi, Ben. Thanks for having me.
Now, you've been working on the migration of services for OBB's ticketing system from on-premises to the cloud. Can you share with everyone what drove the decision for this move?
Well, there were three reasons. The first was reducing cost. The second one is better flexibility by using infrastructure that best suits the tasks and using software as a service offerings. And the third one is a strategic reason. Ticketshop is a white label solution, and we would like to have other organizations in the public transportation sector in Austria to use our platform to sell tickets. The goal is for Ticketshop to be the only ticket selling platform for all public transportation in Austria, and having Ticketshop separated from the railway operational systems makes this more attractive for partners.
Now, you started your migration at the start of 2020, the year that was, and you mentioned that you had some challenges that you faced during the migration. Can you step us through what these challenges were?
Well, the system was initially set up on-prem and we needed to migrate to the cloud while keeping the same level of performance, reliability and security. And Ticketshop is not a simple web shop. Instead, it's a pretty complex system. It includes things like seat reservation, vending machines, mobile devices for train attendants and interfaces to external partners for various purposes like validating students or selling travel insurance. As such, Ticketshop consists of over 50 components and multiple databases and multiple database technologies. Also, when we started the migration, ÖBB did not have much experience with public cloud. ÖBB was just starting public cloud adoption, and we had no company internal frameworks, guidelines, or infrastructure to build upon.
Right. So not only were you taking on this huge project and this very complex system, but also really leading the way for the company with this migration. Now, you mentioned you decided to migrate each component individually rather than a big bang approach. Can you tell us why you decided on this approach over others?
Well, we had a complex system on-premise, high non-functional requirements, limited experience with cloud, and a little amount of downtime available. So with our situation, a big bang migration did not seem feasible. We would have had to do too much at once and take too much risk at once. So we settled on a plan to migrate one component after another. And the problem still was where to start. There was so much to analyze, so much to decide, and so much to set up. And our solution for that was to start with one component of the Ticketshop, which is uncritical from an availability and information security point of view, and moving only this one component to the cloud. That already required a lot of setup, like network, Kubernetes, or deployment infrastructure. And we put just enough effort in to move this one uncritical component and kept in mind that we would have to need to change a lot of things later. From there, we moved component by component and extended our setup as necessary for information security purposes or redundancy, or just added components like caches and databases. And focusing on one component really allowed us to prioritize what to do first. But for this kind of approach, it was very important to be able to change things later on.
Gotcha. And yeah, you actually had a really kind of well-defined process to get these components from on-premises into the cloud. Can you step us through how you did this and just take everyone through what that process looked like?
We started every component move by a kickoff meeting, which was there to identify dependencies and obstacles to the cloud migration of that component. And then we moved the component stage by stage. So we started to move it from the on-prem development stage to the cloud development stage, then through test and pre-production and production. And that also included the database migration if one was necessary. So we had some relational databases, some document-oriented databases that had to move them with the component. And the way we moved individual components was by replacing them on-prem with a proxy, which acted as the moved component and forwarded the traffic to the component in the cloud. This way, for stateless components, we were even able to just direct part of the traffic to the cloud. During all this time, we still terminated traffic from clients on-premise. And only when we had most of our components in the cloud did we start to terminate the traffic directly in the cloud.
Now, in addition to the migration process you took in getting all these components into the cloud, you also managed to take advantage of some of the resiliency features of Azure as well. Can you share a little bit about how you approach resiliency, both during migration as well as now that you're running in the cloud?
Well, in the first steps of the migration, we were just able to switch back and we did not have much redundancy in the cloud. But later on, we used the feature of Azure Zones. So now we have a zone redundant setup where even if a whole zone in Azure goes down, the components still continue to run. For most of our components, we might have been one of the first users of zone redundancy in Azure. For example, for our Postgres database, for Redis, and also our Kubernetes cluster is zone redundant.
Now, it sounds like you've had a really, really well-defined process set up to move those components over and also get them set up in this high resiliency architecture. What were some of the lessons you learned through this process that you'd share with others who are looking to undertake a similar migration?
Well, the most important thing for us was to stay flexible. There will be changes in the environment and in the setup, no matter how much one plans ahead. So one of the most important things is to have your infrastructure as a code, because that makes it so much easier just to change things later on. One issue we faced during the migration was network connectivity. I would recommend everybody who can to use an express route to migrate into the cloud. It makes it a lot easier. We didn't have one and we faced some issues. One more thing in the end is that I came to enjoy that Azure is really transparent. In an on-prem environment, basically all the information about the setup is there, but to actually get the information, you usually need a meeting with multiple people. In Azure, you have the Azure portal and you can just go in there and have all the information of how things are set up.
Some really great lessons there around not only taking advantage of some of the tools in Azure, but also maintaining flexibility during that migration. Walter, thank you so much for joining us on Customer Tech Talks. It's been great to hear your story and how far you've come.
Thanks, Ben, and thanks for letting me share our story.
Of course, if you want to learn more about any of the migration tools and best practices that are available for your own migration, you can follow the links on screen over to Microsoft Learn to get started. And don't forget to follow us on social for all the updates on latest episodes. And of course, if you think you want to have your story featured on Customer Tech Talks, you can email us at cttalk@microsoft.com to get started. Thanks again for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you on the next episode.